Well, honestly, if I can just be honest for a second, I really don't know where this is going today. I really don't. I just feel like Holy Spirit's messing me up this morning, and so bear with me, please. I want to talk about being positioned for encounter. We are pressing into God because we want to be positioned to be able to encounter His presence. That's what I want. Anybody here with me? I want to know His presence. I want to be empowered by His presence. And when we get into His presence, then we can experience His glory at a different level. And that's what the church needs in this day. We need to know the glory of God at a different level, because we have a world that is dying, and time is running out to be able to, you know, have them come to Christ. And so we want to press in. We want to press in hard. He's just been messing me up over the last couple of weeks, as I've been just praying and spending time in worship. And I'm hearing Him in greater ways than I have for a while. And I want to pass on to you some of the things that He's been talking to me about. And being a Spirit-led church, we are able to follow the Holy Spirit's lead when it comes to things like that. Amen? We want to hear what the Spirit of God is saying so that we can follow His lead and know where He wants to go. And every one of us needs to be able to be in that place, because Holy Spirit wants to talk to each and every one of us. And as we are led by the Spirit, He can take us into places and to do things that we might not experience before. And I think we need to really begin to press in as a congregation, as a church. I want to take you to the book of Acts this morning. And we're going to go to Acts chapter 5, verses 12 to 16. But let me give you a kind of a synopsis of what's happened up to that point in Acts. In Acts chapter 1, we see the ascension of Jesus, and He's telling the disciples, I'm leaving, but I'm going to be sending you the Comforter. I'm going to be sending you the Holy Spirit, who's going to empower you to be able to do the work of the ministry. And you will be empowered to do the signs, the wonders, and the miracles that you've seen me do. And in chapter 2, they are obedient. They go to the upper room as Jesus had instructed them. In chapter 2, as they are in that place of prayer and worship, they experience what Jesus was telling them was going to happen with the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And they began, each one of them, every one of them that were there, were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. And once this happened, They were amazed that, you know, all the people that were out there listening and saying, you know, that crowd must be drunk. But it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. And they were all amazed that they found that people were speaking in each of their own individual languages. And once they were empowered, Peter was able to preach the greatest and most anointed message ever. He was able to tell them exactly what happened. And as he preached, they added a lot of people to their number that day. And it said those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. Wow, what a revival. 3,000 people. And from that point, it says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. And a deep sense of awe came over them all. And then the apostles performed many signs and wonders. Up to that point, they had been obedient. They were open to what Jesus said, even though they had no clue what that was going to look like, what it was going to feel like, what it was going to sound like. They had no clue. They were just obedient to what Jesus said. And then they began to do signs, wonders, and miracles. They met together in one place. They sold everything. They brought in all their possessions, and they shared with each other everything that they had. Peter heals the crippled person, that man that was crippled, and he said, I don't have any silver or gold for you, but I'll give you what I have. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Amazing things began to happen. And faith in Jesus' name began to heal people miraculously. Then Peter and John, they were taken before the council because they didn't really like what was going on. They couldn't understand what was happening, and so they wanted them to stop. They said, don't preach in the name of Jesus anymore because we don't like what we're seeing. It's kind of scary. But they stood up in righteousness. They stood up and said, no, we are going to do this. They explained to the religious leaders what was going on, and they received threats from the religious leaders about, don't do this anymore. But you know what? It says that after even they were threatened, it says that they prayed and said, God, you hear their threats. And now I pray that you give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. Stretch out your hand with healing power, and many miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. You know what? I find it kind of amazing at that point that they didn't pray for protection. They didn't say, Lord, shelter me, put a hedge of protection around me, don't let anything come against me. No. They said, give us greater boldness. Even though they are persecuting, even though they are threatening to kill us or throw us in jail, they are telling us, don't you dare preach in the name of Jesus. They went and they asked for greater boldness. That's a pretty bold thing to do. And so we're at that place in chapter 5 where Ananias and Sapphira, they tried to deceive by only bringing in a portion of what they actually had. And, of course, they died because of it. And now we're at Acts chapter 5, starting at verse 12. And it says this, the apostles were performing many miraculous signs and wonders among the people. And all the believers were meeting regularly at the temple in the area known as Solomon's Colonnade. But no one else dared join them, even though all the people had high regard for them. Yet more and more people believed and were brought to the Lord, crowds of both men and women. As a result of the apostles' work, sick people were brought out into the streets on beds and mats so that Peter's shadow might fall across some of them as he went by. Crowds came from the villages around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those possessed by evil spirits, and they were all healed. Why? Because they got into the presence of God. They obeyed what the Holy Spirit wanted to do. They put themselves in that place where they were reaching out to God for those signs, wonders, and miracles, reaching out to God for more of his presence. And as a result, they were able to do the things that lately we have been asking for. And so what is it that brings those things? They were experiencing the tangible evidence of God's glory, and they were touching lives by it. First of all, his presence changes everything. His presence changes everything. When we get into the presence of God and we love to be in his presence, then we can encounter a taste of his glory. I want that. When Moses was talking with the Lord, he says, "Show me your glorious presence." And then the Lord replied, the Lord continued, "Look, stand near me on this rock as my glorious presence passes by. I will hide you in the crevice of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by." Moses had to live. He lived in a day when it wasn't quite the time when we could experience the Holy Spirit like we have him now. We don't have to go to the cleft of the rock and have him cover himself. We can be in the presence of God because he invites us to be. And God is not just passing by. God is resting, he's abiding, and he enables us to live in his glorious presence. You know, Jesus loved to go to Bethany. It was one of his favorite places because Mary, Martha, and Lazarus were there. And Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, they loved it when Jesus came. They invited Jesus to come. "Just come, Jesus, sit. Just talk. You know, you don't have to teach us anything. You don't have to do anything. Just come." There were a lot of other people who loved Jesus' presence because of what he did. You know, they wanted to be near Jesus because he showed those signs, wonders, and miracles. Maybe they wanted to be in his presence because they thought he was kind of an odd kind of spectacle. But Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, they loved just having Jesus' presence. And Jesus got so close to them. And that's one of the things that draws the presence of God, is when we love to be in his presence. It's the passion of our heart to want to be in his presence. Is that your passion today? Is that your passion? Would you do anything to be in his presence, no matter what it costs? See, God loves to be with those who reciprocate his love and love to be in his presence. And when we get into the presence of God, we can never be the same again. Never be the same again. You know, the problem is that a lot of people, they will come to church and they're Christians, but they love to come to church for, you know, "What can I get today? What can I get today?" They want to come and have their needs satisfied. You know, they go through the motions of worship. But there's a difference when people come because everybody longs to be in the presence of God. Can you imagine a room full of people, every single one of us, and maybe even every chair filled with people who came because they wanted to be in the presence of God? The sole reason for coming. "God, I just want more of you. I want to encounter your presence. I want a taste of your glory." Can you imagine the sound that would arise in this place? I want that. But many will come to church because they are consumers. They will consume all they can get with as little effort as they can give. And we are not called to be consumers. We are called to be people who go, people who give, people who serve, people who talk about the kingdom. We're not called just to consume. And so we have his presence changes everything, and we want it. And so we need to pursue it. We have to pursue it. It's like the parables that Jesus told in Matthew 13. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that a man discovered hidden in a field. In his excitement, he hid it again and sold everything he owned to get the money to buy the field. And then again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant on the lookout for choice pearls. When he discovered a pearl of great value, he sold everything he owned and bought it. To give everything for that one thing. That one thing that we want to pursue, the presence of God. To experience the tangible glory of God. What would you give for it? Would you, as it were, sell everything in order to get it? We're called to pursue it. To experience the glory of God, we go to where the glory can be found. God can lead us to that place, and he can give it to us, but we need to be willing to step into the place where glory can be found. And when we do, we become so influential. There was tangible evidence that Moses was touched by the glory of God. And there will be tangible evidence that we have been touched by the glory of God when we get it. It says Moses' face shone with the evidence of the presence of God. You can't be in his presence truly and not become visible with his presence. We carry it with us. We want a glory encounter, but you know what I find in Scripture? I find that Moses climbed a mountain to get it. I find that the priests in Solomon's temple, they sacrificed and they dedicated the temple when they received it. I find that Jesus brought the glory, and at the cross, he bought it for us so we could have it. The disciples went to the upper room and waited and prayed and worshiped to get it. John was exiled on the island of Patmos when he received it. See, we can't fully expect to receive the powerful presence of the glory of God when we are asking casually for it. It's not a come to church on Sunday and God, okay, if you have something for me, we have to pursue that. That has to be our one thing that we come and we gather for. That has to be the one thing that when you go into your prayer closet at home that you are seeking. God can give us suddenlies. You know, when we're living in that glory place, when we're living out of his presence, we can have those suddenly moments. Those are cool moments. Divine appointments. We see those suddenlies at the call of Isaiah and the call of Jeremiah, the call of Ezekiel. Daniel, that suddenly in the lion's den. Moses in the burning bush, that was a suddenly. He didn't expect that. Jacob's dream at Bethel. You know, Mary was visited by an angel. Paul certainly got a suddenly. We can have those suddenlies, but we need to pursue God. We need to live out of his presence. And then worship. You know, we practice his presence and not practice as in rehearsal that we go through the motions. We practice his presence as in we live with intentional moments for divine opportunity. When we come into the place of worship and we get right into his presence, those are intentional moments of divine opportunity. My flesh doesn't understand that. My flesh cannot experience the Spirit of God. It can manifest what's taking place on the inside of me, in my spirit. But, you know, my flesh will not desire to do anything spiritual. It can't. And that's where we find the tension sometimes. Our spirit wants to engage. Our spirit wants to go to those places, but flesh says, nah, not today. not feeling well enough today. My flesh says I'm tired. My flesh says I'm too weary. My flesh says it's too much work. But my spirit wants to go, and there's this tension. Know what I'm talking about? But we have to come to the place where we want it. And so we're going to tell my, I'm going to tell my flesh, I'm going and you're coming along for the ride. John 4:24 says that God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. I want to experience all that God has for me. I want to encounter his presence. I want to know the manifestation of his glory. Even if that means climbing a mountain, even if that means sacrificing somehow, even if that means worshiping in a manner that takes me beyond my flesh's comfort zone, getting into a room alone, removing the worldly things from my life, I'm going to tell my flesh that this is what we're doing today. This is the way we live life now. Worship is a powerful means to connect with God. And that's why we do it. And that's why you're encouraged to do it at home in your prayer closet. It doesn't matter how well you sing. It doesn't matter anything. We just worship and make a joyful noise. We worship because, God, I just want to be in your presence. And so we need to be in that place of worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And that means I need to get to a place that is beyond my flesh. We need to have breakthrough in worship and connect with the Spirit of God in such a way that we are positioned for divine encounters. And it's so important in today's world that we get into his presence and we position ourselves. The world needs to know. There's, as Cammie prayed earlier, there are people that are dying. There are people that are suicidal. There are people that are suffering depression, physical ailments, so much. There's poverty. And when we can take to them a taste of our glory encounter, they can be changed forever. That's why we have the outreach team. We want the outreach team to be able to take what we do here and take it out there because people need to know. That's why we have the cafe, because we want to be building bridges to the community. We've been talking about breakthrough, and the target for breakthrough last month was financial breakthrough. And this month, I want to focus our breakthrough on worship because we really need to break through in that area of worship. Our fast this month on February 26, 27, 28, I want us to pray for breakthrough in worship. And there's strategy concerning that. And so if you are participating in that fast, we will be having a discipleship around that after the praise and testimony night with Jim on the 26th. I encourage you to come. And also the new intercessory prayer strategy. This past week, we pushed back the chairs. We had music going, and there was only Linda and I here, but we prayed up a storm, and we worshiped. And I don't know, Linda, did you feel like the presence of God? Yes. That's the place of, okay, flesh, we're doing this, and you're coming with me, right? So once flesh gets the idea, we move past that. But the Spirit of God is so real in those moments. And if you want a taste of what it is to get into the presence of God in a powerful way, Thursday morning, 9:30, I encourage you to come out. It's a combination of praise and worship and prayer, just calling on God to bring change to our community, calling on God to bring revival, calling on God for breakthrough. So what do we take away from all of this? We can be Spirit-led in every area of our ministry here, and we need to be. From top to bottom, from side to side. If you are especially in a place of leadership in any capacity, we need to be Spirit-led. We've not been called to be consumers. We've not been called to come and sit and do nothing. We've been called to use our hands and feet. We've been called to use our voice. We've been called to use our wisdom and our gifts in order to bring salvation to the lost and encourage one another. We want to experience the glory of God. And so we need to go where the glory can be found. We need to step into that place, no matter what it looks like, and say, God, I'm willing to go. We can have suddenlies when we are consistently in alignment with the Spirit of God. When my walk every day, step by step, is in alignment with the Spirit of God, we can have those suddenly moments. And worship is a powerful conduit for glory encounters. And I need to go to the place that is beyond my flesh. So what are you willing to do when we come together on Sundays? Are you willing to go past your flesh? That's hard. But our flesh wants to sit and listen to the music. But our spirit needs to engage with worship. And so I'm challenging you. I'm challenging you to take yourself to a deeper place in worship. It's not about working harder and harder in order to find God. It doesn't come because we work up a sweat to try and get there. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about being open and willing to go past the place of flesh. What does that mean? That our desire, we desire more than we currently have. Do you desire more than what you're currently experiencing? I do. I know that there's more. Maybe you've heard that song, "There must be more than this." Spirit of God, there must be more than this. I know there's more, and I want more. We become positioned when we lay down fleshly desires. We become positioned when we willingly go past where our flesh resists. And we become positioned when our desires for more overrides my flesh's resistance. Can you say that of yourself this morning, that you want more of him than what your resistance is telling you? I want more and more and more of him. And we can have that. We can go together to those places. So this morning, we're going to close with a worship song. You know it. You probably don't need to be looking at all the words up there, but engage yourself in worship. And if what I've been talking about is you, I'm going to challenge you, I'm going to ask you, encourage you, that you would come and join me up here. Just to get out of your seat, just to tell your flesh we're going. And to come up here and begin to worship. And those that come up, I'll just pray over you that you will be able to receive, that God will take you to that deeper place. Okay? Let's stand together. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just thank you that we can be in your presence. Thank you, God, that we have the privilege of being in your presence. And so, God, I pray that as our hearts cry out, that you would take us deeper, that we would have glory encounters, that, Father, we would be able to take from your presence and offer it to other people. God, I pray that your presence would be evidenced in such a tangible way, Father, that we can see those signs, wonders, and miracles that we've been asking for. And so, God, I pray that you would stretch our tent pegs in worship. I pray that when we come together, that it would be for the purpose of seeking Jesus, of knowing you more, of getting closer to you, of coming into your presence, God. And so, Father, we just thank you for what you are doing. I pray, God, that you would build on what you have begun here this morning, and that, God, you would make us bold, bold to be and do and go and have your way in our lives, God. And so, Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Thank you.